Hello students, I welcome you all in my lecture series on physics of nanomaterials for physics 2. Myself Dr. Suchorita Bhattacharya, associate professor of physics from Guru Nanak Institute of Technology, Kolkata, is delivering my lecture session for third semester BTech course, and the streams under considerations are computer science and engineering and information technology. Today I am starting my lecture 4, that is the last lecture on physics of nanomaterials. Let us now take a look what is there in today's lecture session. Actually, students, you know that we are in module 5 of physics 2, the code PH301, where physics of nanomaterials are delivered. Total number of lectures allocated 4, and today I am going to give you the lesson on this 4th lecture, which includes basically the applications of the nanomaterials in the form of the material itself, that is the quantum dot, graphene and carbon nanotube or CNT, as well as the applications in the field of environment and medical uses. The questions to be addressed in today's lesson are quantum dots and applications. The quantum dot, what is quantum dot? That is already introduced in my previous lectures, and we will extend the discussion of quantum dot and its special applications. Then we will go for the graphene, a special material. What is graphene and where it is applied? Next, we will move to carbon nanotube, its structure and its applications. Then we will consider the use of nanotechnology in environment. Then what about the medical applications of nanotechnology? That we will try to highlight. Okay, so let us start our today's lesson. The first is the tune the band gap of quantum dot, the artificial atom. Two new terms are there. First thing is tune the band gap, and second thing, the artificial atom. Though the term quantum dot is known to you. Now, we know that when a material is reduced to a small number of atoms, the energy bands spread out and break into discrete energy levels. Naturally, the band gap widens. In the last class, we have discussed in very detail that if there are a small number of atoms in a particle or the material, the energy bands spread out and break into discrete energy levels. Naturally, the band gap widens. Now, semiconductor particles at the nanometer size scale, where this is very, very prominent, is known as the quantum dots, which we already know as zero dimensional semiconductor particles. Isn't that? Now, in the language of material science, nanoscale semiconductor materials like quantum dots, they tightly confine either the electrons or the electron holes. Now, quantum dot is a single object with bound discrete electronic states like the natural atoms of the molecules. That's why they are called artificial atoms. Very, very important, because by reducing the dimensions in all possible three directions in nanometer range, you can prepare the, you can make the quantum dot. And when you are reducing all three dimensions to nanometer range, the quantum dot, what you are getting, it will give the discrete energy levels, just like the case of natural atoms or the molecules. That's why the quantum dots are called artificial atoms, because starting with the bulk material, you can make the quantum dots of many sizes. Okay, Now, as the band gap of nanoscale semiconductor varies with their physical size, I just mentioned that you can change the size of the quantum dot, and if you change the size of the quantum dot, naturally band gap width will change. The smaller the quantum dot, the bigger is the band gap. Smaller the quantum dot, the bigger is the band gap, because the discrete energy level separations will be more and more. And when there is a change in material's band gap energy by changing its size, obviously the energy of the emitted photon or absorbed photon will also be changed, so also the wavelength, because we all know that E equal to h nu means hc by lambda. So lambda equal to hc by E. So lambda is inversely proportional to energy. Obviously h is the Planck's constant and c is the velocity of electromagnetic wave, that is photon, in free space. Okay, so energy of the transmitted photon you can control by controlling the size of the quantum dot, accordingly the band gap. Obviously here excited electrons release their energy and drop back across the band gap. Excited electrons, when drop back across the band gap, they release the energy and you can get the corresponding energy wavelength in the form of photons, that is lambda equal to hc by E. Now, if the band gap is small, so what about the energy? Obviously, emitted photon has less energy. And if the band gap is large, naturally opposite will happen. And this direct proportionality between the size of the band gap as well as the emitted photon energy is equally valid if there is absorption of photon, where a photon must have at least equal to the band gap energy. That means in case of photon transition, whether it is emission or whether it is absorption, this band gap size and the energy of transition, they are proportionately varied. Okay. Now let us take a look at this diagram. Look here. Large number of atoms are here. Okay. Naturally, the band gap will be smaller. And what about the corresponding photon energy? Emitted photon has low energy because energy is directly proportional to frequency. So emitted photon low energy means low frequency. So what about the corresponding wavelength? Wavelength will be larger. Wavelength will be larger. So small band gap, large particle, large wavelength. Small band gap, low frequency because of low energy, but particle size is large, so wavelength will be large. That means in the red end of the spectrum, you will expect the emitted photon wavelength. Okay, now look here. This is the small particle. So number of atoms are very small. So what about the band gap? The band gap is large. Band gap is large means you are getting the emitted photon to have the high energy. Naturally high frequency. So what about the wavelength? Wavelength will be small. That means this relationship clarifies the reason for the shift in the optical absorption and emission of the quantum dots towards the shorter wavelength as the dot gets smaller. Just take a look. Dot is small, band gap energy more, so frequency more. So what about the wavelength? Wavelength smaller. So shift of the wavelength will be in the shorter wavelength range as the dot gets smaller. But if the dot is larger, quantum dot is larger, the shift will be in the large wavelength range. Let us take a look here. This is the graph showing the graphical variation of fluorescence versus wavelength. Just take a look. Small size, so what about the wavelength you are getting? And small, large size, what about the wavelength you are getting? So when quantum dots are larger in size, wavelength shift will be in the large wavelength range, that is in the red range of the spectrum. But when the quantum dots are smaller in size, obviously the wavelength shift will be in the shorter wavelength side, that is the blue shift it is told. Now, as a specific example, larger quantum dots whose radius 5 to 6 nanometer, larger quantum dot, the wavelength of 5 to 6 nanometer, look here, the radius is 5 to 6 nanometer, emit longer wavelength. That means in the red range of the spectrum. And small quantum dot, radius 2 to 3 nanometer, emit shorter wavelength. So it is in the blue end of the spectrum. Accordingly, color of the emitted light varies, though specific color also depends on the exact composition of the quantum dots also. Quantum dot size overall, the size definitely control the transmission, the transition photons wavelength, but at the same time, the specific color also depends on the exact composition of the quantum dots. For example, cadmium sulfide and zinc selenide dots, they are sized to emit blue to near ultraviolet light. That means they are smaller in size. Cadmium sulfide and zinc selenide dots, they are sized so to emit blue to near ultraviolet light. Whereas cadmium selenide dots, they can emit light across the entire visible spectrum. Very, very important. It is very special one. Cadmium selenide quantum dots, they can emit light across the entire visible spectrum. On the other hand, indium phosphide and indium arsenide can emit light in the far red and near infrared region. So indium phosphide and indium arsenide, they can emit light in the, they can emit the radiation rather in the form of or absorb in the far red and near infrared region. So cadmium selenide, this is, these dots are of moderate size and they can emit light across the entire visible spectrum. Similarly, they can absorb it too, okay? Now, the application of these colored quantum dots, what about their application? We understand the fact that we can change the size of the quantum dot. Accordingly, the band gap will change. Accordingly, the emitted photons wavelength will be of different colors. Now, these colored quantum dots with tunable transmission qualities, tunable transition qualities rather, not transmission, it is transition qualities, can be used in tagging and tracking the biological species to create special inks in dyes and paints, in light displays and in chemical sensing, in inkjet printing and spin coating, because small size quantum dots can be suspended in solutions. Just take a look here. Cadmium selenide, zinc selenide, zinc sulfide, zinc oxide, these different type of semiconductor quantum dots are arranged here. Now, these type of quantum dots with tunable transition qualities, because why tunable? Because you can size, you can have the different sizes of the quantum dots. Naturally, band gap energy varies. Accordingly, the transition quality will change. You can use them in tagging and tracking biological species. You can create special inks in dyes and the paints, In light display, you can use them, and in chemical sensing, you can use them. And this is very special one, that these type of quantum dots can be suspended in solution. So in inkjet printing and spin coating, you can use them. Now just take a look. Studies have shown that cadmium selenide dots can be made to seep into cancerous tumors in the body. Thus, when exposed to light, the particles glow and helping the doctors, the surgeons to identify the sick cell, leaving the healthy cell alone. Few minutes back, we got the idea that cadmium selenide covers the entire visible range of the spectrum. Their size are like that, cadmium selenide quantum dots. So what about its advantage? It can be made to seep into the cancerous tumors. Okay. So when exposed to visible light, because entire visible spectrum can be used there, these particles can glow. So the surgeon who is taking care of the cancers, he can get the idea about the position of the sick cell, leaving the healthy cell alone. Okay. Now, particles of titanium dioxide, TiO2, and zinc oxide, that is ZnO, both are metal oxide. They are metal oxide semiconductors. They are used in sunscreen as they absorb the ultraviolet radiation. Particles of both of these materials, they can also scatter the visible radiation, making them very good white pigments in the paint, but the same property can turn the skin white also. Obviously, you students are very much fond of using the sunscreen when you go in the deep sun, okay? So you use the sunscreen. What is the basic material? Titanium dioxide and zinc oxide, these are metal oxide semiconductors. They absorb the ultraviolet radiation. That's why they are widely used as sunscreen. And particles of both of these materials, they also scatter the visible radiation. So they are very good white pigments in paints also, but the same property we are using. If you use prolonged these two as the sunscreen in the form of sunscreen, they can turn the skin white, which is not at all good, definitely. Now let us move to another area, that is the band gap in solar cell, how we can use the quantum dot to improve the performance. A typical band gap in a solar cell is 1.4 eV. Now, light from the sun is composed of the whole range of the spectrum, we all know. Now, solar cell act as a low-pass filter, absorbing photons with energy greater than 1.4 eV, the band gap in solar cell. So, these contribute to the power output of the solar cell. And the extra energy is lost as heat. Photons with energy less than 1.4 eV are not absorbed. They are either scattered or passed through the cell. That's why it is called the low pass filter. Okay. Now, if you use the quantum dots, you can have the better efficiency of the solar cell. How? Because quantum dots can be used by changing their size and naturally the corresponding band gap. Now, if it is possible to make a solar cell using layers containing different sizes of the quantum dots, covering the whole range of the spectrum of the photon, definitely it can boost up the efficiency of the solar cell. But this is the possibility, and working is going on. Still, it is not completely in use, but mind it, it is a very, very positive possibilities, and work is going on here. That means using quantum dots of different sizes, you can have the solar cell using different layers. Naturally, you can cover the whole spectrum of the photon energies by varying the band gaps. And it will be possible to drive up the efficiency of the solar cell. Now, because of these highly tunable properties, The quantum dots are of wide interest nowadays, definitely. Potential applications also include some special uses in the form of transistors and solar cells. Solar cells already we mentioned, and in case of transistors, we are familiar with resonant tunneling transistor as well as single electron transistor using the quantum dots, about which we discussed in detail in electronic uses. They can also be used in light emitting diodes as well as diode lasers. They are used in quantum computing, the quantum dots. They are used in medical imaging too. The quantum dots are also used in medical imaging too. So I think you got the idea why I told at the beginning that quantum dot is the central area of research in nanotechnology. Is growth and development gives the growth and development of nanotechnology as a whole. Isn't that? Let us now come to another material, very special one, graphene and its application in nanometer range. The name graphene suggests to you that it is very much related to graphite. I think all of you are understanding, obviously. Now, graphene is the world's strongest material, which is used to enhance the strength of other materials. Graphene is the world's strongest material, which can be used to enhance the strength of other material. It is a single thin layer of graphite. You are familiar with graphite? The soft, flaky material used in your pencil lid. Obviously, it is allotrope of carbon, possessing the same atoms, but arrangement is different. Naturally, the material gives you different properties. You know the different allotropes of carbon, like the diamond and the graphite. You are already familiar with diamond too. They are all allotropes of carbon. They have widely different natures because their arrangement of the atoms are different. Diamonds, for example, are incredibly strong, while graphite is very, very brittle. Now, let us take a look at the graphene. Here, you are finding it. It is one atom thick crystalline form of carbon. The carbon atoms are held together by very strong sigma bonds, and they are arranged in a two-dimensional honeycomb lattice or in a hexagonal arrangement. This is a graphene sheet, very typical graphene sheet, and you are getting the idea that one atom thick. So one atom thick crystalline form, and here the carbon atoms are held together by very strong sigma bonds. And this is the honeycomb structure, or you can say the hexagonal arrangement. These graphene enhanced composite materials can find in general the uses in aerospace, uses as building materials. They are used in mobile devices and many other applications. A very special one we are going to discuss now in the form of carbon nanotube. So I hope you are understanding what about the world's strongest material at this stage, that is in the form of graphene, which is nothing but the allotropic form of carbon, that is in the form of graphite, but here it is formed as a sheet, which is one atom thick crystalline, and the atoms are held together by very strong sigma bond. That's why it is considered to be the world's strongest material. It founds different applications in various areas. The very special one we are now going to discuss in the form of carbon nanotube, the CNT. Carbon nanotube, the CNT. Now take a look. The tensile strength of high carbon steel is around 1.2 GPa, means gigapascal. But The tensile strength of carbon nanotube, just take a look. It is 63 gigapascal, which are made from graphene sheet. So carbon steel, high quality carbon steel, we all know that they are very strong. But what about their tensile strength? It is only 1.2 GPa. Not only compared to carbon nanotube, which is 63 GPa, it appears only. But it is a huge one, definitely. Now, what about this carbon nanotube? The name suggests that it is a hollow tube up to a few hundred nanometer in diameter and made up of carbon. These are formed essentially from the graphite sheet, which appears somewhat like a rolled up, continuous, unbroken hexagonal mesh, and the carbon molecules are at the apex of the hexagon. Okay, this is the structure of a carbon nanotube. Obviously, the very, very large structure I am showing you so that you are understanding it, but mind it, its diameter is few hundred nanometer only, which is made up of carbon and basically the graphite sheet, which appears somewhat like a rolled up continuous unbroken hexagonal mesh where the carbon molecules are at the apex of the hexagon. Now these nanotubes, they are the members of Fullerin structural family, where molecules consist of carbon atoms connected by single and the double bonds so that they form the closed or partially closed mesh with fused rings of 5 to 7 atoms. Let us take a look. The molecules may be hollow sphere just like this. It may be ellipsoid, tube or many other shapes and sizes. So it is a very typical Fullerin structural family where the molecules are made up of the carbon atoms, which are connected by single or the double bonds. And this type of closed mesh it is forming, look here, with fused rings of 5 to 7 atoms. Here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a 5-atom ring you are getting. Similarly, somewhere it may be 7 atoms too. The molecules may be of this type of shape like hollow sphere. It may be ellipsoid, tube, or many other shapes and the sizes. So this type of Fullerin structure gives the carbon nanotube so much strength of the order of 63 GPa. Now, single-walled carbon nanotube, it has a single cylindrical layer of atoms, obviously comprising a single molecule. Similarly, multi-walled carbon nanotube may consist of two or more obviously nested single wall carbon nanotube, which are joined mostly by the weak intermolecular forces, or maybe single graphene-like sheet, which is rolled up several times. That may be possible around a cylindrical hollow. That means it may be made up of a single graphene-like sheet, but which may be rolled up several times around the cylindrical hollow, or it may be large number of single wall carbon nanotubes which are joined by weak intermolecular forces. Okay, so you used to get the multi-walled carbon nanotube. Obviously, it will be much more stronger than the single wall case. Now, what about the applications of these carbon nanotubes? Recent studies have highlighted the prospect of using carbon nanotube as building blocks to fabricate three-dimensional macroscopic scaffolds. Macroscopic means obviously the dimensions in any of the three more than, much larger than 1 nanometer. That's why it is in the macroscopic range. These are porous and all carbon scaffold using both single as well as multi-walled CNT as the building blocks. That means you can use the three-dimensional macroscopic porous all-carbon scaffold using single-layered or single-walled and multi-walled carbon nanotube, which are used as the basic building blocks. Now, they possess macro, micro, and nanostructured pores. And this porosity, you can tailor for specific applications. That is the most advantage of this type of scaffold. These three-dimensional all-carbon scaffold may be used for the fabrication of next-generation energy storage like supercapacitors, field emission transistors, photovoltaics, and biomedical devices and implants. So these type of three-dimensional carbon scaffolds, they are mostly used as next-generation energy storage. You have heard the name of supercapacitor and obviously the field emission transistors. These type of structure, you can use these scaffolds, three-dimensional all-carbon scaffold using the carbon nanotube, you can use for the generation of these type of storages. Carbon nanotubes in general use for applications in automotive parts, boat hulls, and sporting goods. They are used in water filter, thin film actuators, electronics, and obviously electromagnetic shields. Now let us take a look. Organized carbon nanotube structures such as this type of forests. Similarly, the urns you can think of. That means large number of this type of carbon nanotube structures, they can form the urn whose width may be of the order of micrometer. These are in the nanometer range, but several number of these type of carbon nanotubes you can use to form the urns whose width may be of the order of micrometer, making them much, much stronger. You are understanding, though they are produced much smaller in volumes. And these type of strong carbon nanotubes, because of their strength, they may be proposed as tether for a purported space elevator. They can be considered as tether for purported space elevator. So the strength of the carbon nanotubes give their applications in very special areas like automotive parts, boat hulls, sporting goods also. At the same time, even it may be considered as a tether for purported space elevator. I hope you are understanding that how much strong it is, so that this type of special applications are considered. Okay. Now let us come to the new area, that is nanotechnology in medicine. Actually, few minutes back, we considered the different quantum dots which are broadly used in medical applications. In addition to that, nanomedicine is a branch of medicine which applies the knowledge and tools of nanotechnology to the prevention and treatment of disease, which involves not only the medicine like the quantum dots, but the use of nanoscale materials like biocompatible nanoparticles, as well as, most importantly, the nanorobots for diagnosis purpose, for delivery purpose, for sensing and actuation purposes in a living organism. Here it may be mentioned that the manufactured nanorobots are used to make repair at the cellular levels. I hope you are understanding that how important it is. These are called nanorobots, which can use the repair at the cellular level. Just take a look. This is one of the nanorobots, what we are getting here. It can swim through blood vessel, and it is using the drug delivery. Look here, it is using the drug delivery. This is one of the nanorobot. It is swimming in the blood vessel. This is the picture of a blood vessel where it can do the drug delivery. Okay, there is another figure. Look at, this is another nanorobot. This is another nanorobot which is used here to treat the cancer. It is actually programmed in such a way that this type of robots can seek the cancerous cell and can treat it. This is another nanorobot which is specified for the cancerous treatment in the form of the seeking and the treating the tumor cells, and which is computerized, definitely programmable, computer programmable. Okay, so this is the use of the nanomedicine. This is the nanomedicine. Okay, not only in the form of quantum dots, but these are very special one in the form of nanorobots, which can make repair at the cellular scale level. Now, medical applications of nanotechnology also include the size of nanoelectronic biosensors, and even possible future applications of molecular nanotechnology in the form of biological machines. So here working is going on. These are evolving area, nanoelectronic biosensor, as well as the molecular nanotechnology in the form of biological machines. Now look here, very interesting one. Functionalities can be added to nanomaterials by interfacing them with biological molecules. So you are familiar with computer interfacing. Now take a look here. Interfacing the nanomaterial with biological molecules, because the size of nanomaterial is similar to the most biological molecules and the structures. So nanomaterials can be useful for both in vivo and in vitro biological research and application. That means inside the body and outside the body, this type of applications you can use in biomedical research as well as application, because the size of the nanomaterial is similar to that of the natural biological molecules. That means you can use the interfacing between the nanomaterial with the biological molecule or the structure. So nanomaterial can be interfaced with biological molecule or the structure. Very, very important one, and totally new evolving area where work is going on, because here the nanomaterials can be useful both in vivo and in vitro biomedical research and application. That means inside and outside the body. Though current problems for nanomedicine is understanding the issues related to toxicity, obviously is there, and environmental impact of the nanoscale materials. This is also the area of concern, because it is a new evolving area. So these parts still under considerations, which is related to toxicity and the environmental impact of nanoscale materials. Okay, so let us now move to the nanotechnology in environmental issues. We all know that nanomaterials have special physical and the chemical characteristics or the properties, which are used for novel environmentally friendly products, and obviously to improve the environment, which includes cleaning up of existing pollution, at the same time improving the manufacturing methods so as to reduce the generation of new pollutants, and making alternative energy sources mostly cost effective. Obviously, this is quite natural, because you, in case of the environmental applications, you have to first think of reducing the pollution, or the pollution, what is already existing, how to clean up that. So nanomaterials are used for this purpose because of this very special physical and the chemical characteristics. At the same time, nanotechnological products, they contribute significantly to the environmental and climatic protection by saving raw materials, energy, and the water, and by reducing the greenhouse gases, okay, and the hazardous wastes. The products are now used to reduce the greenhouse gases and the hazardous waste. Nanotechnology-based dirt and the water-resistant coatings, nowadays are used as an example which reduce the cleaning efforts. Because energy reduction you are asking for, the nanotechnology based dirt and water resistant coating, you used to get the advertisement regularly in television. It reduces the cleaning effort. Obviously, if you don't need the cleaning effort regularly, it will be cost effective, isn't that? Now, in the chemical industry sector, nanomaterials can replace environmentally problematic chemicals in certain field of applications. It can boost energy and resource efficiency. In case of the battery recycling, economically attractive, it makes the battery recycling, actually nanomaterial, economically attractive, where pure zinc oxide nanoparticles from the spent zinc and manganese dioxide, zinc manganese dioxide batteries can be recovered. From there, pure zinc oxide nanoparticles are found to be recovered from the spent zinc manganese dioxide batteries. Nanotechnology-based solutions for oil spills, they offer great promise for the future, though at present it is in the nascent stage, but work has been started and nanotechnology-based solutions for oil spill will give us the new path too. It is very, very important area. Now come to this special case. Titanate nanofibers are used as absorbents for radioactive waste cleanup, where the unique structural properties of titanate nanobeads and nanofibers help to remove the radioactive cesium and the iodine ions in water. This is a new area also. Titanate nanofibers, they have the unique structural property, so they help to remove, because of that, the cesium and the iodine ions in water. So waste cleanup they can do. But nanotechnology currently plays a rather subordinate role in environmental issues, because the environmental engineering companies, they offer very limited importance or applications to nanotechnology in their respective fields. That's why still now it is evolving, but not in the flourishing stage. Okay, so we hope the situation will change soon in near future. Let us expect that, because many new areas then we will come out. Now let us move to the multiple choice questions, as I used to did in my all chapter contents after the end. Let us take a look here. Materials in nano range should have at least one of the dimensions of, there are four options: 0.1 to 100 nanometer, 0.1 to 100 millimeter, 0.1 to 100 centimeter, 0.1 to 100 into 10 to the power minus 5 meter. Now just take a look. Material in nano range which have at least one of the dimension of 0.1 to 100 nanometer. In the very first lesson, we were being introduced about that. So option A is correct. Quantum confinement is zero. Quantum confinement is zero in three dimension, two dimension material, one dimensional material, or zero dimensional material. Confinement zero where? In the bulk structure, that means in three dimensional material. So quantum confinement is zero in three dimensional material, that is in the bulk structure. Now size confinement is maximum. Size confinement is maximum, just the opposite one. In bulk material, quantum dot, quantum where, quantum well. Now size confinement maximum means you are talking about the zero dimensional material. Now which one is zero dimensional here? Obviously quantum dot. We have learned it very clearly. So option B is the correct one. Next one, Energy band reduces to discrete energy states if constituent particle numbers of the material are small, large, infinitesimally small, infinitesimally large. So, when energy band reduces to discrete energy states, if number of particles very small, like the individual atom or the molecule. So, here we have four options. Which one will be correct? Infinitesimally small. Here only small is given, but another option is infinitesimally small. So, it is the correct one. Now, strongest material of the world is carbon steel, graphene, steel, alnico. Few minutes back, we got the idea that it is the graphene. Okay. Now, carbon CNT, I'm sorry, I gave you, almost gave you the answer. CNT refers to copper nanotube, copper nanotube, carbon nanotube, carbon natural tube. So, CNT refers to carbon nanotube, not copper nanotube. Be careful. Okay. Copper is a metal, but not copper nanotube. It is the carbon nanotube because it is basically made up of the graphene sheet, which is rolled up as a tube. And graphene is the allotrope of carbon. So, be careful. Which of the following quantum dots is used to detect cancer? Cadmium sulfide, zinc sulfide, cadmium selenide, zinc selenide. A few minutes back, we got the answer in the form of cadmium selenide. Okay, cadmium selenide is used to detect and treat cancer. Quantum dots of smaller size shifts absorption peak in the spectrum range of blue, green, yellow, red. Obviously, blue will be the correct answer because you are considering smaller size. So, what about the shift of the absorption peak? Quantum dot smaller size. So, what about the band gap? Band gap will be larger. Band gap larger means frequency larger. That means wavelength smaller. Now, which wavelength is minimum here? Obviously, the blue, because we know it is the VIBGR. So, blue is the minimum here. So, A will be the correct answer. Physical example of particle in a box problem is quantum well, quantum rod, quantum dot, classical system. Physical example of particle in a box. First thing, particle in a box, it is a quantum system. So, no case of classical system arises. And particle in a box, it is a very special one in the form of the quantum well. Already we discussed during the explanation of quantum well. A one-dimensional nanomaterial is one-dimensional nanomaterial, graphite, graphene, carbon nanotube, quantum dot. What is the one-dimensional nanomaterial? Obviously, carbon nanotube. Carbon nanotube, quantum dot is zero-dimensional, and graphite, graphene, they belong to the sheet. That means two-dimensional one. So, carbon nanotube is the one-dimensional one. With reduction of dimension of a material, surface to volume ratio increases, decreases, remains same, become negative. Obviously, it increases. We have discussed in very detail for the two lessons, first and the second one, that with reduction of dimension of a material, surface to volume ratio increases. Next is quantum dot is an example of one-dimensional object, two-dimensional object, zero-dimensional object, three-dimensional object. And I understand you students all know the correct answer as the option C, that is the zero-dimensional object. Okay. And now the students, I hope you understood all the contents of this portion of physics of nanomaterials and the proposed broad questions also I gave in the form of questions to be addressed at the beginning, and these are the possible multiple choice questions which I already also discussed. So I hope you understood and you enjoyed these contents that is in the form of physics of nanomaterials. So let us end today here. Thank you very much for your cooperation and you listened it properly. So definitely we will meet in some other class. So till then, let us complete our today's session. Okay. Thank you, my dear students.